So welcome. It is Friday. You are excited to learn the science behind pricing, designing for value with our superstar behavioral scientist, Dr. Isabel Macdonald. You're wondering, does she have a farm? I don't know. You'll have to ask her. Poor Isabel has had to deal with those jokes for way too long. But about Isabel, she has a PhD in public policy from a place called Harvard University with a specialty in behavioral economics. She is passionate about how a deeper understanding of economic and psychological forces can guide the development of technology tools for social good. She doesn't do social evil, she just does social good. She's worked with financial institutions, NGOs, and government agencies to implement large-scale experiments, as well as to develop tech products that help users achieve their financial and professional goals. Previously, she was a consultant for the talent practice for Mercer Consulting. In this role, she advised Fortune 500 companies on developing talent pipelines, HR analytics, and compensation strategies that maximize employee motivation and productivity. In addition to her work at Irrational Labs, she also holds a postdoctoral research position at the Haas School of Business at UC Berkeley. Her current research, which is fascinating, explores how mobile apps help teachers implement remedial education and how blockchain and crypto-backed wallets advance financial inclusion globally. On a personal note, she's a wonderful, kind person, always insightful, always a great listener and in tune to share her expertise in ways that will transform your life and your thinking. And last but not least, she just had her first baby. So little Luna is 9 months old. Give her a round of applause for babies. And with that, we go back and I say, welcome. We're always excited to have you here. I will stop. Isabel, make the magic happen.
Fantastic. Well, thank you, Ryan, for that kind introduction. And thank you to you all for coming out on a Friday to spend some time talking about the behavioral science of pricing. So I thought since it is a Friday morning, we could start just by talking about our cup of coffee. And if we went out to Starbucks this morning, how did we make that decision of whether to buy a cup of coffee or not? So the standard rational economics approach tells us that this is a very simple decision. We're just comparing value and price, and if value is greater than price, we buy, and if it's less than price, we don't buy. So it's easy, right? But behavioral economics tells us that it is not about this comparison of value to price. It is perceived value versus perceived price. And that is what is going to make us buy. And really, that value is not something that is an inherent fixed trait in a product. It is very much susceptible to change. So we're going to be thinking about these two levers, value and perceived price, and how they relate to each other, how they trade off, and how that is going to impact people's buying decisions. But I'll give you one other illustrative example before we dive in. If I told you there are two coffee options for you this morning, one that costs $1, one that costs $5, which would you choose? So you can think about that to yourself there. But I am a Seattleite. I am shameless in my snobbery about coffee. So I would absolutely go with this $5 option. Hands down, I know this about myself. If I only had this price information, this is definitely the one that I would choose. And what is going on here? Because those of us who took an Econ 101 class know that it is supposed to be the case that if you increase your price, that demand will fall. But in fact, with this circumstance, I am actually preferring the coffee that costs more. And why is that? I'm making an assumption that the more expensive coffee must be better. And I'm a coffee snob, so that is what I'm going to go with. So this is just to highlight that thinking about behavioral science is critical if you are determining a pricing strategy, because people are going to make inferences about value from the price, and this ratio of perceived value, perceived price is going to determine if people will buy. So today we are going to take a tour through five overall concepts that are critical to the psychology of pricing. That is relativity, attachment, pain of paying, fairness, and framing. And for each of these, there is so much that we could cover, but to give you a flavor of some of the insights that are at play here, for each of these, I'll give you a principle that you might be able to apply today to something that you're working on. I'll show you some insights from the research about what we know. We'll talk about some applications to real products. And since we have a lot of irrational heads in the audience, a lot of you are behavioral science enthusiasts verging on experts here, I'll give you some bonuses. So if you have been around the block a few times, you know reference points, endowment effect, stick around for this bonus that's really intended to up-level your knowledge there and give you some extra insights to think about. Our goals for today is that you will walk away with some tactics that could boost perceived value, limit perceived price, and therefore lead you to more buyers or subscribers for whatever product you might be working on. But some very important caveats before we dive in. The first is that perceived value doesn't come out of nowhere. If you are still in the place, perhaps you're working on a startup and you're searching for product market fit, you haven't quite gotten to having a product that really is truly valued by your customers, this presentation will not give you tools to change that. So definitely better use of time to focus on developing underlying value. And then you can think about what is the best way that you can frame that to your customers so they can increase their perception and really understand the value that you're delivering. And the second caveat is that we really are not about marketing gimmicks here. The goal is not to manipulate people into buying things that they don't actually want, because really what we care about is long-term buyers and subscribers. So as we go, this is something that I want to circle back to really ensure that we are protecting trust and we're really serving the interests of our customers while doing our best to help them understand the value we're delivering and to reduce the pain associated with having to make a purchase. So with that as some scene setting, let's dive into our first foundational concept that we're going to talk about, which is the theory of relativity, but of course in a behavioral science sense. So one principle that's critical here is this idea of reference points. So anytime you make a purchase, if you're in the grocery store and you're thinking about whether to buy this lettuce here, you are going to be comparing this lettuce both in terms of price as well in terms of value. Does it seem organic? How big is it, et cetera, to a reference point that you have in your mind, which is a standard for price and value that has been set. And this is critical to all the foundations of behavioral science. You've probably heard of Kahneman and Tversky's prospect theory, which really emphasizes that people are not making value judgments in the absolute. You're comparing to a reference point and deciding if any new purchase might be a loss or gain on top of that. So there's lots of fascinating research in this space. One study that I really like is a study of New York cab drivers. And these economists found that actually taxi drivers work more hours on days when the hourly wage is lower, which does not make sense. Again, coming back to our core supply and demand curves from Econ 101, it is supposed to be the case that if you pay people a lower wage, that they will work less. So what's happening here, of course, reference points. Cab drivers often are setting in their minds a goal of how much they need to earn in a certain day. That's a reference. And if they haven't reached that point, then they're going to keep working longer hours. So reference points clearly driving behavior that is deviating from what we expect in standard economics. So how does this apply to products in the real world? So think for a minute about If any of you have done a meal kit service like Blue Apron or HelloFresh, what do you think is the price reference that people are comparing in their minds to decide if this is a good deal or not? So think for a moment about that. And then think about how some of this branding on the website is trying to shape your reference here. So I think for a lot of people, if you are used to cooking, you might be thinking about how Blue Apron prices compare to the cost of groceries. But they're really clearly trying to shape the reference instead to eating out and the cost of a meal out, which is, of course, more expensive. And so then by comparison, the Blue Apron prices look better. So this is something to think about of what is the reference point that people have for your product. And if it's not something that you like, is there a way that you can shift intentionally to a reference that is more favorable and really communicates the value, especially the value for price that you are providing? And then a bonus here, we often think about reference points as being external to our product, but it's also really important to think about how your own product offerings can be creating reference points and if there's a way to kind of play your product offerings off each other. So this is an example of what we call a decoy. This is from MailChimp. So they start you off with this premium offering of $299 a month, which you think, wow, that seems really expensive. But then by comparison, the standard offering for $14.99 seems super reasonable. So this is a great way that they are using this premium offering to set the reference at $300. And then the other products look much more reasonable in comparison. All right, so there's so much more we could say about relativity, but let's move to our next concept, which is about attachment. The more attached and invested we feel in a product, the more we are willing to pay for it. And one key concept here is this idea of an endowment effect, that when we feel like we actually own something already, the more that feeling can be strengthened and emphasized, the more we are attached and the more we are willing to pay. So the picture here is a mug, because many of the classic research studies on the endowment effect involved mugs. So the very standard setup looks something like this. Some of you might have seen this before. So if I say, which of these would you like? Would you prefer a chocolate bar, or would you prefer this nice mug with a rabbit on it? So think to yourself, am I a chocolate person? Am I a mug person? But imagine that instead the scenario was this. I had given you a chocolate bar. It is sitting on your desk. You're looking at it. You can hold it. You can smell it. And then I ask, would you like to trade for this mug, or would you like to stick with your chocolate bar? That actually changes people's decision-making substantially. So if we're in the first scenario where I just show you both things and I say, what do you want? It's about 50-50, maybe slightly more people are mug people versus chocolate people. But if I give you the chocolate bar to begin with and ask if you want to trade, all of a sudden, around 90% of people are sticking with the chocolate bar. And of course, it reverses if I give you the mug. So this is very clearly an illustration of the endowment effect. If you feel like you own something already, then it's painful to have to give it up. Again, coming to this idea of loss aversion, prospect theory, where we code losses as much more painful than gains. And so people don't want to give things up. So what is a way that can actually be applied in product, and how does that relate to pricing and willingness to pay? So one really good example is Warby Parker. I'm not sure if anyone has gotten their eyeglasses through them, but they have this option where you can actually take the glasses home and wear them around for a while, try them on in the comfort of your own home, and they find that people are much more willing to buy after that. So it's a core component of their strategy. And what's behind this is, of course, the endowment effect, because people feel like they actually own the glasses already, and then thinking about having to give them back then becomes painful. So perhaps this is a good opportunity to step back and think about something we talked about in the beginning, which is about long-term trust and avoiding marketing gimmicks. So we know that the endowment effect is absolutely at play here and is part of the reason that this works well for Warby Parker. But we can ask ourselves, do we think, even knowing this, that you know, the endowment effect was used perhaps to get them to buy these glasses, do we think customers feel manipulated by this or regret their purchase? I would guess for the most part, no, because in fact, it's quite helpful for customers to be able to take the product home and really experience it and think before they want to buy. So I would think that most customers are quite okay with this application of the endowment effect. So this is the style of thinking we want to be doing as much as possible of, are we really thinking about the best interest of our customers and making sure that we are using these tactics ethically. So one bonus here to think about, we often think of endowment effect as a tactic that we can use perhaps to increase willingness to pay, but it can also be a big barrier if you are working in a marketplace product space. So this is an example from Poshmark, which is a consignment website that allows you to list your products and people, or list things that you own and are ready to pass on and people might buy them. But the endowment effect can be a really big barrier here, because what it tells us is that the people who currently own these shoes, perhaps you've gotten to wear them around, you feel attached to them, you are going to be expecting a higher price than people might be willing to pay. So this is a barrier that in this case, designers would have to be really intentional about thinking about how you can get people over this hurdle of the endowment effect and feel less attachment to the items. All right, so we're cruising here. There's so much to cover, but let's talk about the next topic, which is this idea of pain of paying, which tells us that every time we make a purchase, it psychologically hurts us. And that is probably for the best. It's one of the ways that we are psychologically conditioned to avoid overspending. But it's also a problem if you're trying to sell anyone anything, because the more that they are thinking, reflecting on this act of making a purchase, the more painful it is and the less people might be willing to buy. So what is some research on this topic? The research suggests that avoiding things like a la carte, pay-as-you-go pricing from a psychological perspective is probably for the best. So maybe most of us are taking Ubers now. We don't have this experience regularly where you're sitting in the taxi and you're watching the price increase gradually, and it is so painful. And that is absolutely the pain of paying at play. The more that we're thinking about how each additional mile we're driving, or each time we're using a product, if we feel like we're being charged extra for that, it does become quite psychologically painful and people are less likely to engage. So you definitely don't want to be in this scenario where people are thinking, should I use this product an additional time and it's going to cost me this much? You don't want them to be focused on that. You want them to be focused on value. And that is a rationale that perhaps you really want to be focused on all-inclusive pricing. So that is one strategy that Netflix, one of the behavioral science experts, employs really well. They emphasize you get unlimited viewing on all your devices for one simple price. And that is really taking into account this pain of paying, trying to limit it as much as possible. But one bonus, one exception caveat to exactly what I just told you is to think about experience boosts. And this is a bit of a flavor of a la carte pricing, but in very specific controlled environments. So this is an example from Tinder. You have this special paid option that for each of these super likes, you pay an additional amount. But we think in terms of the overall effect behavioral science here, this probably is quite effective despite being a form of a la carte pricing. But a few criteria that boosts really need to meet in order to be effective, they really need to offer immediate benefits. There is good research that the pain of paying is reduced if we feel like we can benefit from it immediately. Obviously, it has to be things that are highly valued that people would attach a specific dollar amount to and be willing to pay that. And it has to have urgency. So in this Tinder case, you feel like I might miss this match if I don't stand out by sending this super like. In other cases, you might think about a tasting menu, for instance, and you've already paid, but then they're offering you this special option to upgrade to the Wagyu beef for, you know, an insane amount of money. That is an experience boost. And you have urgency here because you think, if I don't do this now, perhaps this is my one chance in life to have this really special experience. So boosts are one exception, one scenario, but you really need to be careful about this. From the behavioral perspective, all-inclusive pricing is the better way to go. So the next topic that we have is to think about fairness. And this is something that I think standard economics also really neglects, is that people do really care about whether they think a price is fair or not, and it will impact their willingness to pay. So one natural experiment that happened that economists love to discuss is Coca-Cola tried to do something a little bit like surge pricing or traffic tolls being higher when there's high traffic times. They thought, okay, we can apply a very similar concept and we'll switch our vending machines to when it's hotter outside, we will charge more because we feel like demand will be really high. And then when it's cold and demand is low, then we will lower the price. And this seems like a great strategy. We think this will really boost revenue. But what happened, people hated it. They felt like Coca-Cola was taking advantage of them when they were super hot and thirsty. And so Coca-Cola actually saw a huge drop in revenue from employing this pricing tactic. So what is an alternative if people think that that sort of price discrimination is really unfair? How can we use fairness to actually increase people's willingness to pay? Here's one really good example from Everlane that they have this really high level of transparency about costs to make their shoes. And then the goal here is to communicate to people that these prices are very fair. And then you can see at the bottom, they also have this comparison of the Everlane shoe to the traditional retail price that you would pay. Think to yourself, what is it? What is the name of that tactic? You feel like I've just seen that. That is, of course, a reference point. They're showing you this comparison to traditional retail versus their product. But really, I think this is an excellent example of how transparency can really be used to increase a perception of fairness. And then one bonus caveat, additional nuance to this whole discussion is that people in the Coca-Cola example did not like being charged different amounts at different times, but research has showed us that some types of price discrimination are seen as more fair. So specifically loyalty discounts or some timing-based changes where if you have an early bird price versus a last minute price hike, people seem to accept that a little bit more. And I think the key distinction here is you feel like you, as the consumer, had some control over which price you were getting here. If you were a loyal subscriber, or if you had been on top of things, you got the early bird price, then you would have had control there over the price that you saw. And that people perceive as a bit more fair. All right, so the last topic that we'll talk about is framing, which is how small tweaks can have a big impact on if people are willing to pay and how they perceive your price and value. And I'll focus specifically on temporal framing for the example here, which this is really focused on subscription services to think about at what time increment are you expressing the price of that subscription. And what we've seen from the research is that showing smaller time increments, such as the price per day, people perceive that as being less than the overall annual roll-up. So one study, they asked if people would contribute to a charity for 85 cents per day or $300 per year, which is the same price overall, but much more people were willing to donate when it was framed in this daily amount. So you've probably seen this out in the wild as well. This is an example from Indeed where they show the price at the daily amount, and then presumably this is billed more weekly or monthly. So just another opportunity to emphasize the need for trust here. I do think this tactic is allowed. However, it is really important that elsewhere on the page, you're also communicating to people how this translates into an amount that is going to show up on their credit card bill. So you don't want people to be negatively surprised when they realize how much this actually is going to impact them at the point of purchase. And then one bonus, super interesting, some research has shown that for much larger amounts, this effect actually flips. So they did this comparison, $1 per day or $365 per year, people perceive the per day cost as being lower. But if we're talking about a bigger amount of $1,150 per day or over $4,000 per year, people actually prefer the large lump sum. So these are two perhaps ends of the spectrum of a pretty big lump sum versus a much smaller amount. I think many subscriptions probably are falling somewhere in between these things. And we don't have a lot of research about what exactly is the point at which this flips and people prefer the lump sum versus the dollar amount. But this is something to keep in mind if you do have a higher price subscription. All right, so that was our quick tour through these five concepts. Again, we have relativity, attachment, pain of paying, fairness, and framing. We have only been able to scratch the surface here. There's so many more psychologies at play and a lot of nuance here, but we can get into that a little bit in your questions, and really looking forward to hearing what sort of questions people have. And I see there's lots of conversation in the chat. I haven't been monitoring the chat, but perhaps Ryan, you can direct me to what question to take first.
I know, so many questions, but before we do that, if we could give her a virtual round of applause for your wonderful genius. And I did want to compliment you on many things, Isabel, but in particular, I loved your use of the five icons on the top of the slides to represent each thing. I was really into that coding there. So thank you. With that, I think let's do this way. There are a lot of the questions, Isabel, are around context and when does this work and when does this backfire? All great questions. Let's do it with virtual hand raising. So let's start with Sharon and then raise your virtual hand if you want to rock some more questions, and I'll just call on you as your hands come up. So Sharon, kick it off. You're also in Seattle. So bring it.
Hi, Isabel. Great presentation. Glad to hear you're also from Seattle. So I had a question. This has come up quite a bit with a client that we have that is a gigantic owner of apartment buildings. So they have thousands of apartment buildings. And when they price a la carte, they get feedback that says, I feel nickel and dimed. But when they price at one flat rate, they show up as being more expensive than their competitors. And because the buy cycle is so long, it's one purchased and then it's not made again for another 12 months, it's really difficult for them to do some testing on this. So I would love to get your thoughts on that.
Yeah, well, Sharon, love meeting a fellow Seattleite. So hope you're enjoying the reprieve we're having from the heat wave here. Yeah, this is really, I think you've gotten to the crux of the issue here of people really just like this a la carte, feeling like they're being nickel and dime, constantly having to reflect on price is making the pain of paying worse. But I think it really comes down to how are people doing their search? And especially, is there some system by which they have set criteria and they're not even going to see the options that don't meet that criteria, especially with price? So I was actually house searching in the Seattle area, and we had set a price on Zillow that we would only get alerts within that price. But then we realized that if something is, you know, $50 or $100 a month different, perhaps we want to consider that, but it's not even coming in to our view because we've screened it out. This is another classic example in the dating app world. Tinder allows you to sort and screen people based on height. But of course, there is no evidence from the research that height actually matters for dating success and happiness. But by introducing this criteria, you're just screening people out. So I think the thing to really understand for this client is, how is it that people are searching, and what prices are we being screened in or out? And then once you can kind of solve for that, so in my personal experience, I saw that a lot of places were establishing this set rate of all utilities were billed monthly, and for some amount that was clearly not just covering utilities. So they might be charging $600 a month, and that wasn't showing up in the rent quote. And so that was enabling these properties to appear in people's searches if they had set a rent limit, but then they were finding some ways to actually charge more. So that's annoying, but probably beneficial from the apartment's perspective to make sure that they're appearing in people's searches. And then it becomes a matter of how you are communicating your prices once you have the opportunity to actually have that discussion with people. And so this is the Netflix approach. They're really emphasizing that we have this all-inclusive, very simple pricing mechanism where you get all your shows for one simple price. And we could think about an equivalent for this apartment complex to really emphasize other places are going to be charging all of these extra fees they really work in. We are avoiding all of that. We're just charging you one simple thing. This is a very transparent rate, and to really be emphasizing that to customers, that's a message that I think would come across well. So to summarize, they do have to be sure that they're appearing in searches, not getting screened out, but they also want to think about how they can communicate the strategy that they have of a simpler pricing scheme.
Great, thank you.
Yeah, nicely done on the summary there, Isabel. Avi, tell us, where are you coming to us from, and what is your question?
Hi, all. Hi, Isabel. Thanks for the really fascinating presentation. I'm from Durham, North Carolina, and I was curious if there's any more information around these studies and the socioeconomic status of the participants, and if there are any differences that are known, because I know, you know, we often talk about the marshmallow test and how there's you know, other factors that may be at play segmenting different consumers and behaviors. So curious if we know any more there.
Yeah, I think this is an annoying answer, but of course it's going to depend on the particular psychology at play. I think actually a lot of my academic research has been more in development context and thinking about things like microfinance, which is serving a very specific socioeconomic bracket of lower literacy, lower financial literacy, and how that factors into decision making. And there's been a lot of research about how If we're talking about financial products, for instance, people really do not have an ability to distinguish between what is the best price of these things, given all of these extra fees that get added on. So kind of to Sharon's point here of how all of these fees stack up. I think actually Irrational Labs has done some research about with auto car purchases, people really neglect all the extra things that they have to pay for, like insurance and gas and all these things that should factor into the price, but you don't have a transparent way to see that. But what the microfinance literature shows us is that it is critical for lower income, lower literacy populations, that you are finding simpler ways to communicate prices that are more transparent and help people make comparisons easier. So some economists have tested nice summary tables that put all of the information very clearly, allowing you to make these comparisons, and really a plug for regulators to think about requiring that sort of price transparency and clarity to help people understand. I think that's especially important for some populations, but honestly, that's something that would benefit all consumers. We see across the socioeconomic spectrum that people are often not fully absorbing the information about prices and really need more transparency. So I think perhaps the broad answer to your question would be definitely certain populations we have to be more careful, and probably thinking about this question of trust, avoiding gimmicks, certain groups, we need to be especially thoughtful about that. But probably for each specific psychology, there might be some nuance and a lot of research, I think, can help clarify that.
Yeah, I think one of the most interesting parts of your presentation was the interaction of the psychologies at points, right? Where you're like, well, this could cancel that out, which is always the case, as we're talking about in the chat. Sharon, coming back for more, bring it.
Okay, sorry. I'm glad I have an opportunity to ask a second question. So thanks so much for this, Isabel. It's so fascinating. So I wondered, I loved your idea about being very transparent. And I also wonder if the higher value that our client would charge, the higher price, if that also conveys quality. And so that might be a good thing. I'm wondering, from an experimentation standpoint, what might be the best way to test this? Because they've got that long buy cycle of like 12 months, you know, like you buy once and then you don't buy re-up until 12 months later.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm really glad that you asked about this. Doing research on people's willingness to pay and price perceptions is famously difficult, because it's really hard to just ask people, you know, how much would you pay for this apartment? Especially if you haven't made a lot of apartment purchases or rented a lot of apartments, and this is a new decision, you have very little information to just come up with in the abstract and make that decision. But people tend to be better at giving you, we call it choice-based information, of you have this apartment option and you have this apartment option, which one would you prefer? So my recommendation for this client would actually be to go out and do some user testing with consumers and just see, you know, people coming in. You could be showing them these different options of you have this with this set of amenities versus this with this set of amenities. Which of these do you generally think you might prefer? And that gives us some information about your preferences. And then we can help tailor, you know, what we're showing you to these options. That might be a way that they could really start to get some information about people's preferences. And then the goal there would be that you're kind of shifting the prices and set of amenities that you're showing people, and getting a sense of what people see as the real trade-offs there. And you can frame it more as this is like an intro quiz to really get to know you and think about how we're personalizing our options. That would be one way to get a sample to participate in this. But I think in past presentations, we've talked about pretesting and using things like Amazon's Mechanical Turk or Prolific, some of these online platforms that just allow you to recruit a big sample of consumers to do a survey. That could be another option for them to get people's just general reaction, but would really push them to more these choice comparisons of this or that versus show someone something and say, how much would you pay for that?
Right. That sounds good. And then maybe also seeing which one then follows up after the tour, the one presented with the a la carte or the one presented with the all-in-one. That's great. I love the Mechanical Turk. I forgot about that. That would be great.
Yeah, absolutely. And then my other suggestion, and I don't mean to say this lightly, is that they really just need to be sure that they are tracking all of this. So often we feel like we get a general sense of people's, you know, willingness to buy or follow up, and we have these anecdotes in our mind of people didn't seem to like this versus like this. But actually collecting that data and tracking is really important. One hypothesis I might have is that people don't like being nickel and dimed. They'll complain about it, but it's also possible that in the end, they end up making the purchase more with that strategy. Again, because of this, what we talked before about the screening element. So would encourage them to really be sure that they're collecting the data on people's end decisions and using that to guide their choices versus these kind of anecdotes that build up.
Yep. Great. Thank you.
I'm going to just, before I call in the hands, we have some dots to connect from the chat. Are you ready, Isabel?
Please.
Okay. The first question was, Katriana asked about reading in relation to behavioral science and finance. Now, I did post our top 10 B-side books of all time, the greatest hits album, if you will. I also post our ultimate guide to behavioral science resources, which has lots of like B-sci finance themed podcasts and PDFs and organizations and all that. That said, Isabel, what would you add to the like must read financial B-sci list or must follow?
Yeah, so just general finance or pricing specifically?
Well, we have both questions, so I would actually, okay. You could do general and then pricing, yeah.
Yeah, I guess not to be shameless in plugging our co-founder here, but Dan Ariely does have just fascinating research on this relation of price and value. So I think many of you have probably read Predictably Irrational already, but would just revisit specifically that chapter on pricing. That still, I think, stands out as a core element of the behavioral science of pricing and value. For finance in general, I really like Katie Milkman's book, How to Change. I think there are some nice examples. She's done a lot of research on financial behavior, so that's really good. If you are interested at all in the microfinance, more development world, there is this really cool book called Portfolios of the Poor. And it just tracks, it's much more qualitative, but just tracks people's decision-making about finances and how they have these very complex inflows, outflows that they're constantly managing. There's a lot of really interesting behavioral science insights, just navigating people's decisions and how they're balancing all of these different things that are quite complex and have very clear systems and rules. So that's another cool book to add.
Yeah, no, that's awesome. I knew you'd have something a little off the grid, and that was it. So thank you. Lynn, why don't you jump in next? Tell us where you're at and what's on your mind.
Hi, Ryan. Okay, I have a question. How specific can I be, or should I try to generalize my question?
Ooh.
I mean,
what do you think?
Yeah, up to you. I'll tell you what. The more The more specific you are, the more helpful I can be in terms of giving a concrete response. So
yeah, okay, that's great. And if you feel you need to generalize it or something, you know, you do that in your answer. Okay, so I live in a 55 and up community, right? So you got people 55 up to like early 90s. And I am, among other things, a trained yoga instructor, and people have expressed interest in having me teach in the community. So it's already a little bit, you know, I live here, but I want to teach here maybe and charge people for it. So you've got that, right? But I don't need to teach here, right? And it's really not part of like a core element of my business that I have going, right? So I don't feel a need to undersell myself. On the other hand, I also, these are my neighbors and I want to be yada yada, right? So I've done, you know, I've done my market research and I know what is being charged by yoga studios around the community area, right? Now, I'm not going to be teaching in a yoga studio. I'm going to be in a community room. So you don't have all the amenities. You don't, you know, people will have to bring their own stuff. But also, most of the yoga studios don't offer senior discounts, right? And the only other piece of data.
So is the question, are you thinking about how you're going to price these yoga classes?
Yes. And the only other piece of data I have is that someone used to teach here who was not a resident. The last time she taught here was about 2 years ago, and she was charging $11 an hour with some, like, you know, monthly pass kind of options, right? And, yeah. Right.
Yeah, so, I think that actually... It's really interesting to think about the reference points here, because in some ways the reference of what someone was charging previously is similar to when a lot of products face this, of when you try and increase your prices, people hate it because they have this reference of what was charged in the past. But I think you also have this really great opportunity to use a reference point of what others are charging currently. Like if people were to go out and search for a yoga class now, what they might be paying. And I think you can combine that with this idea of fairness and really come up with a good price. So you might say, and really to communicate this openly to people, I did a survey of yoga classes in the area and saw that they cost this amount. And so I am really committed to serving this community. So I'm going to offer some discount off this amount, and that brings me to X dollars. And just put that out there and not really have a lot of discussion about it, because I think when you open things up to discussion, then people will give you, have the opportunity to question, is that a fair price or not? You know, what's the value? All these things. I also probably wouldn't reference that, you know, you don't have all of the equipment, because on the flip side, you're offering this other perk, which is that it's very convenient and presumably closer to people. So that is the trade-off value that you are providing. And you're also just really emphasizing the community aspect. Presumably people would like to do a workout class where they can also be meeting people. So think about all of these values that you're bringing to the table and really be able to articulate those to people and then justify your price based on this survey that you've done. I think that's probably a pricing scheme that would be well received.
Okay, now I feel so good, Isabel. Thank you, because I have in my mind a pricing scheme that fits with everything that you just said. So that means
fabulous.
I did good on that, or did well. And you just gave me some better language to be able to articulate, even though like all my reasoning was there that matched with yours. You know, your language was much better than mine, or you gave me some things that, you know, would just be a little bit more convincing or polished. So thank you.
Excellent. Well, the behavioral scientists are behind you here. So that's great.
I absolutely should have just cut the whole thing off. I feel great. End of session. But we do have two more questions. So Avi, come on down, and then Sam.
Thanks. I was curious, related to fairness perception, if people have different norms for fairness of paying for labor versus paying for products, and if there's any other strategies. Like, I saw that Everlane example was interesting because they kind of called out the labor cost there. But even when you think about tech products and such, if there's any more there.
Yeah, well, I think we've all probably seen a tactic applied here at restaurants. A lot of restaurants have raised their prices, and to a T, I feel like they reference the rising costs of labor and desire to treat employees well and all these things. So that, I think, is something that is pretty well received. And I think the one thing that you highlight is, if you are going to share labor costs, you are opening up an opportunity of, if people perceive those wages that you're paying as unfair or too low, then that is an opportunity for criticism, and would also trigger this perception that these prices aren't fair. So that's perhaps one thing to be cautious of if you're dividing up the labor versus the product or input costs. Then that is something to be thinking about. But I think it does really tug on heartstrings and make people more willing to pay when it is a rising cost of labor.
Sam, did you unraise your hand?
No, I just took it down because I was in the queue.
Oh, okay. Well, this show off. You're like, I was taken care of. well, Sam, I'm assuming you're in Utah today.
Yes.
Well,
today I am.
Give us some Utah vibes. What is your question, my man?
Okay, great. Isabel, thank you so much. This was amazing. As per usual, I had a quick question about fees on top of pricing. So I think you spoke of this a little bit. I've been trying to keep track of it, but we at our hotel booking company, we charge fees in addition to the cost of the hotel room. In your experience, would it be better for us to lump those in to one price, or should we disclose each fee individually on the pricing page?
Yeah. All right. So a few things at play. I think there is probably a trade-off between short-term and long-term gains here. I think if you immediately put all of the fees into the initial price, you would probably see a revenue drop. And that's really unfortunate. But over time, we think that probably is a better long-term play. I think it does matter a little bit what the references are to other places that people are looking at, what the reference point is. People do expect some level of fee. So if you do group that immediately into the price, then your prices are going to compare unfavorably. And we turn into this situation that we chatted about with Sharon. I would say, It definitely is a good idea to, rather than saying, here is the booking fee, here is the, you know, occupancy fee or whatever, here, taxes, etc., put it all together in one line item, taxes and fees, or, you know, fees and then taxes. And then people can pull out perhaps a drop down menu if they want to see how that breaks down. Or this is part of fairness. It does help to have a bit of an explainer of what these different fees are. But that in terms of reducing the pain of paying, each additional fee that you are adding on and highlighting, that's additional pain that you're imposing. And so people are going to react negatively to that. So I think having transparency about what the fees are and have them come in very, you know, transparently and simply is probably the way to go. But I, to be honest, just given people's expectations, there will be some fees. I probably wouldn't immediately just put them on top of your prices there.
Okay. Good to know. We'll take a look at it. Thank you.
Yeah. Sounds great.
Awesome. All right. Well, the last question for today, Florin, is that the proper way to pronounce your name?
Falarin.
Oh, okay. Falarin, I can do that too. But Falarin, where are you today? Where are you coming to us from?
I'm in London.
Awesome. Well, bring us some of your British sophistication.
I didn't know about that, but yeah, I'll just stick to a question. thank you very much, Isabel, for your presentation. Very insightful. I'm curious. So, if you're working in a space that you know you've got a lot of competitors in, basically, and you're not a massive company that can benefit from you know economies of scale, there's that issue of okay, so you want to price it in a competitive manner, or you want to like you know be I guess cheaper than another company or more affordable for your customers, but then you also don't want like a price race to the bottom. So these like behavioral insights seem like a good way to mitigate against that price race to the bottom. But I'm wondering if you have any insights about, you know, trying to keep your prices competitive, but also not, you know, making your business unsustainable, basically.
Yeah. So tough question, and probably getting into specifics would be important to decide the exact answer here, because there are just so many different dynamics at play. I think coming back to this idea of price versus value and people inferring a lot of things about value from the prices you are conveying is a really great reason to avoid just doing this race to the bottom of constantly lowering your prices. And that actually perhaps is a nice segue. I have one final example to leave you with that I'll give you this quick story since we started the hour with coffee time, but it's Friday. So increasingly we're getting closer to wine o'clock here, and behavioral scientists love to do studies about wine. But one really cool study that I'll leave you to think about, these behavioral scientists found this winery. They had these two styles of wine, the 2004 and 2005 vintage, that for whatever reason, the 2005 was just orders of magnitude better. So they ran an experiment where they offered people a free sample of one of these wines. And then they also told them the price that people didn't realize was randomly varied from $10 to $40. And then they asked people, how much did you like this wine? And so what they found is that people's liking of the wine, which shouldn't change with the price, did in fact change with the price. For the low quality wine, the more expensive it was, the less people said that they liked it, even though it's a free sample. But with the high quality wine, it was completely the opposite direction. Of the more expensive, people actually said that they liked it better. So this, I think, is just really fascinating and highlighting that there is a lot of nuance in these dynamics and this trade-off between price and value. It is often not the best case to do what the rational economics approach says, which is lower your price to get more people to buy. I really want to think about how you are protecting perceptions of value and framing your product as high quality. So I'll wrap on that note and pass it back to you, Ryan.
That was impressive, because you should all know I was like doing the questions and I looked and Isabel's like, I've got some slides. I was like, uh-oh. So nicely done, Isabel. Timed it like a rock star, which you are. So thank you for this time and your energy today, Isabel, and to everybody. Hopefully this was very high value. Hopefully it was appropriately priced and you learned all kinds of wonderful things. So let's give Isabel that round of applause. Next week, open event, invite your friends and family. If you need irrational help from the Irrational Labs team, reach out to any of us. We always love to collaborate beyond membership. Isabel, go forth. Have a wonderful rest of the day. Everybody else, have an even more wonderfuler best of day. I just made that whole phrase up. And we'll see you next week, everyone. Thank you.
Thanks, all. Happy Friday.